A very good morning and a warm welcome to all our viewers to the Healthcare and Infrastructure e-Summit. We would like to thank our sponsors for this summit, Everest Boats and HIPLA. Let us find out what we have in store for us across the 2 days. Session 1, Government Policies, Ayushman Bharat and Funding Solutions. Session 2, Infrastructure and Construction Technologies. On day 2, we have session 3 and 4, Patient Care Experience Through Digitalization, followed by Technology Advancements in Healthcare.
I think the right time is the designing phase. I mean, that's where I feel all your expertise have to come on table. People are savvy for technology. We are savvy for using new inventions. We are also trying to move away from the conventional way of systems. Now we have such a beautiful material like your boards, which we are using. So those have become very competitive over the time. We are doing one APMC market in Latur. There, the whole concept is that we are putting all the prefab structures all together as a 7 lakh square feet of development. So it's supposed to be complete in 4 months' time. We were able to reduce 30 mm sizes to 19 mm sizes. We were able to reduce the structural costings of the facade. So there are so much of advantages of using the new things.
Let us find out the first topic of our session 1. A debate on what do hospitals think of Ayushman Bharat. The moderator for this session is Mr. Akhil Ganatra, Managing Director, Clancy Global. We have Mr. Joy Chakrabarty, CII, COO, Hinduja Hospitals. Dr. Alexander Thomas, President, AHPI. And Dr. Naresh Trehan, Chairman, Medanta Hospitals. I would now like to hand over the session to Mr. Akhil Ganatra, who will be taking it ahead.
Welcome everyone to a conversation on what hospital thinks of Ayushman Bharat. A small introduction before we get into a debate. Healthcare for all is a key indicator for a developed nation. Ayushman Bharat is the placeholder, the figurehead for fulfillment of this vision and edging towards a developed nation. The two large pillars of Ayushman Bharat are, number one, establishing health and wellness centers to the volume of 1,50,000 even, and number two, the National Health Protection Scheme. The pressure on the infrastructure to provide the sheer volume of beds and facilities is lightly said an uphill task. A task that requires 5 to 6 times of the beds we already have. First, building them, then manning them, then operating them. And while these volumes are getting delivered, iterate ways and options to fulfill the need at the cost of private sector too. Our format for today's discussion is intently kept as a debate. We will first get to see empathetically the glass half full, then the half glass half empty. That is the goods of Ayushman Bharat by Joy Chakrabarty and the bads by Dr. Trehan. Dr. Thomas will follow it through with a balanced view of goods and bads while we end it with a session on rebuttals amongst all four of us. We will straight move to Joy Chakrabarty for speaking for as a proponent and all the goods of Ayushman Bharat. Over to you, Joy.
Thank you very much. And I'm going to be very brief about this point that why it is good, because I strongly believe, and I go back close to 20 years back when I was a student of healthcare management, and we read always in our textbooks that most of the advanced countries, they have universal health insurance or universal health coverage, where India lacks that. We discussed about India government is spending between 0.9% to 1.2% of GDP in this last 20 years, which is not adequate, which is not enough. And 2008, we saw there was a scheme introduced at that time by the government where Rashtriya Shastha Bima Yojana, where again, there was a scheme given for the people who are underprivileged and how they can seek healthcare in private as well as government health facilities, which has not become that popular. And at that background in 2018, September, exactly 2 years back, Modi government introduced this Ayushman Bharat, or popularly also known as PMJY. What it gave? It gave 10.74 crores of Indian families, or close to 45 to 50 crores Indian population, which is close to 40% of population, empowerment to get good healthcare in established, reputed healthcare centers, whether it is government or it is private. And they happen to consume that. And we are very happy to note that in 2020 May, close to 1 crore population have availed this scheme, and more than 13,000 crores worth of reimbursement has happened under this scheme. So that shows that in the last 2 years, it has become very popular, widespread, and acceptable by our providers as well as by the consumers. Now, question arises, and today I need to speak in favor that why it is good and how it is good.
That's it.
Always, you know, till 2000, Indian healthcare had mostly dominated by the public healthcare facilities, but we have seen over a period of time the privatization have started happening. And due to this privatization of healthcare special facilities, the specialized services and all these high-end services started moving to the private healthcare, and that system shifted from supply side health financing to demand side financing, which is something needs to be noted. And as a consequence of that, or in continuation to that, Narendra Modi government has been promoted demand side financing for tertiary care and supply side financing through creation of health and wellness center for primary care. As you know, at the beginning introduction, it has been told there are two aspects of it. One is the wellness part of it, 150,000 wellness center across the country. And at the same time, the Ayushman Bharat scheme, where secondary and tertiary care hospital available in good and moderate facilities across the country. Now it is, I have given a background, or I have given some sorts of information stating that what is happening. And I don't think there is any way we can say it is not creating a good impact. In May 2020, there were close to 30,000 hospitals, including private one, who have empaneled under this program. That shows that government as well as private entities, they have come forward to promote this. And remember, most of these beneficiaries are taking high-end, specialized, super specialized care like oncology, cardiology, or you know, neurosurgery kind of intervention, which otherwise would have remained a dream. And I must congratulate the Indian private sector they have come forward and they have welcomed this move and extended their facilities for the patients who are availing this scheme. We also should not forget that 13,412 crores of reimbursement which has happened under this scheme, that shows close to 14 to 15,000 rupees is the reimbursement per episode of illness. In one hand, it looks good for the government that the average reimbursement rate is not that high, but at the same time, it is also a challenge for the private entities to provide a good quality service at that price. And especially for that reason, what has happened, we have seen hospitals which are in metro cities who have invested heavily to promote their quality care, they find it extremely difficult. And probably that is the cause of concern when you say whether it is good or bad. Yes, it is not necessarily that one product can make everyone happy or everyone pleased. And as a result of that, the high-end tertiary care hospitals in metro cities, they find it extremely difficult. But nevertheless, it is there are other providers who can afford to avail these, you know, packages and offer to the needy. So that is going to be the, you know, that is going to be something good to share. And at this time of pandemics, there are few thousand, close to a, more than lakh of population have availed their COVID care treatment under this scheme of Ayushman Bharat. And that has empowered them to avail their COVID care even in the private facilities. So when I come to this, I must say in secondary tertiary care hospitals, which are located even in tier two and tier three cities, they are able to match their cost with the reimbursement, what is coming under this scheme. And it is giving them a good utilization of their services. It is giving them good amount of revenue to manage and make them sustainable. Especially when our significant percentage of population lives in rural India, we need to create more number of centers. And I strongly believe that this scheme is going to encourage many entrepreneurs to start their entities in tier two, tier one, tier three cities. And people who are living in those places, they are going to be, you know, benefited out of this.
Sorry, Joy, if I can.
Much, yeah.
Sorry, Joy, if I can interrupt. I mean, sort of to move on from the goods of Ayushman Bharat, and you know, sort of for the viewers who don't know, Joy manages or is the main man, if I may say, for the landmark hospital in Bombay called Hinduja. So in terms of his experience with that, it's exhaustive as well. Moving to against, which is Dr. Trehan, though, like he says that he's been the creator of Ayushman Bharat, but also is a promoter of a large hospital, sees the other side of Ayushman Bharat so that we can see what loopholes to fulfill the vision are what we need to start plugging. If I can ask you to take it up, Dr. Trehan, the against, or what are the loopholes or problems of Ayushman Bharat?
Okay, thank you. Thank you for inviting me. As you know, it is a fundamental right for every citizen to get quality healthcare. So if we start with that, we also know that for the last 70 years, there has been a big gap that if you were unable to afford healthcare, you had to depend on government hospitals, and the overcrowding of the government hospitals led to a lot of problems because of the fact that the capacity was fully and still not able to keep up with the demand. So this whole idea of bringing a universal insurance at a level where it makes it affordable by the government and also that the providers can provide to some level. So if you look at it, what are the gaps? If you look at the starting point is the wellness center, which is the best part of Ayushman, that if we can, coupled with the wellness center, which we need to pay attention to, is sanitation, indicators being monitored by the wellness center, we can decrease the disease burden in our country to a level where the demand for tertiary care and secondary care significantly reduced, because people will be healthier, they will have a place to go for early help, there to a level where what a critical intervention is required. So it will help. These 150 wellness centers will serve a big purpose. Now the whole thing is with the National Health Registry, and this, there will be a lot of moving going forward. There will be a lot of relief for people who were left out of the health stack. Now the point problems are the following: how we link wellness center to the secondary healthcare center, from there to the secondary hospitals like civil hospitals or district hospitals, and from there to tertiary care. If we can establish this link, which is still not established, this scheme will always have some breakup points which we can avoid if we actually provide that continuum from the wellness center, which will be present and accessible to every village in the countryside, every small, all the people who are feel left out today can access. Okay, so these are the good parts of Ayushman, and it should have happened, it has happened. Now the problem comes in how to balance the budget by the government for the scheme and the ability of healthcare delivery people to be able to give quality care which is equal to that of any person living in India. So that means that if the packages are made at a level where they are not affordable by the tertiary care providers of high end, where there is education going on, there is high-end medicines and all that is required in some diseases, it puts a big gap and burden on the tertiary care providers in the private space. So if we are to make this whole health stack for India, yes, we should provide this scheme for people who are unable to afford it. But at the same time, we should allow people who can afford it to get a proper treatment and pay for it because they can afford it. And that is what's been happening, that we have somehow at the high end of tertiary care being able to subsidize or cross-subsidize the patients who are to be treated free or under the Ayushman scheme. So that whole continuum has to be worked out still. And there has to be appreciation at all levels to say, what is the real cost of delivery of medicine? What is the real cost of giving sophisticated operations and treatments which require inputs which are quite expensive? So if we can actually match these things, then the shortcomings of the Ayushman scheme or the health stack of India can be actually mitigated by bringing on board realistic pricing. Now, if realistic pricing does not take place, the problem becomes that eventually the system will start breaking down. Now the other thing that the Ayushman scheme administration has to do is to actually pay the bills in a reasonably quick time after confirming that the services were done. Because otherwise, when there are too many bills pending or there is a huge burden of receivables by small hospitals, medium level, even us large hospitals, then the system starts breaking down because we have to take loans at a high cost. So there has been, we need to mitigate this gap somehow. So if at the beginning I said, I am a full-hearted supporter of Ayushman, but at the same time, there are some realistic things that need to happen, and that will actually help us to serve the people who are under the Ayushman scheme, who are under other schemes, who are insured, and who have to pay, who are able to pay for high-end treatment. Then this whole cross-subsidy system will make it happen that the healthcare system will survive. We will continue to give the highest end of care, and the people who are actually now beneficiaries of these, of Ayushman and other schemes, will be able to benefit and get the best treatment, because I believe that the life of every person who stands on the ground of India, it has the same value. It should not be because by some who are well-to-do and some who have had burdens on them, that we should be able to give them the best treatment at the same level. And I think if we get... people around us who are in the same shape. Thank you.
Sorry, Dr. Priyan, thanks a lot for that. You know what Joy started off with, that Ayushman Bharat has already started making an influence. Dr. Trehan said the loopholes, which is the link of the primary care, the link, the wellness centers, and the cost of delivery versus the quality. We've got Dr. Alex to balance these, the gaps and the benefits that we're already seeing, so that the pace of the benefits can increase. And as a representative of healthcare providers, he's got a bird's eye view to the foes of like Dr. Trehan to maybe smaller providers as well. Over to you, Dr. Alex.
Thank you, Akhil, and thank you for having me on this meeting. Let me start with an example, which impacted me greatly. A few years ago, me and Devi Shetty, were going to Belgaum for a meeting. We were on the road. And we stopped at a small town for breakfast. So while we were having breakfast, this middle-aged lady who was serving us came up and told Devi, "Thank you so much, sir. My son is doing extremely well." So Devi asked, "What was it?" So apparently this lady had a child. She was a very poor lady working as a waitress in a very small town. Her son had needed open-heart surgery. Surgery was done without her spending even one paisa. It was done in the best of centers in the world, NH, by the best surgeon. So I'm giving you this example because this is what a universal healthcare should be. And this was done about a few years ago, and it was a state government scheme. And Ayushman Bharat is a much larger and a much better scheme. So I think if it is implemented properly, it will go a great way in serving the health of our nation. As was mentioned earlier, it's an excellent and path-breaking concept. It will provide universal healthcare, make universal healthcare a reality to all our citizens. It will also, I think, very importantly, prevent catastrophic spending, and this will in turn will prevent millions of families going into the BPL. So of particular importance, of which was also mentioned earlier, I think very important is the concept of the wellness clinics. This, I think, will considerably reduce the disease burden, and consequently also health expenditure would come down. I think the other important point of the wellness clinics is that we are using the Ayush system, which is known for its effectiveness and its cost effectiveness in promoting wellness and good health. But in the background of this, I think it's important that a few facts need to be kept in mind if the implementation is to be successful. I do agree with Joy that, yes, there has been involvement, but the extent of involvement of the private sector is not as it should be. Because I think if there is effective partnership of the private sector, this Ayushman Bharat will be a huge success, and other countries will also follow this. So let me just come up with a few points. I think we have to remember, and this has been said earlier, that 70% of healthcare delivery in the country, and almost 90% of tertiary healthcare is done provided by the private sector. The government has beds, but it's a very small percentage, 30%. And even in these hospitals where there are beds, an average of 60 to 80% vacancy is there in the cabinet of specialists. So this really hampers the work of the government hospitals. So when we talk about 70% of Ayushman being delivered, you know, the curative part of it being delivered by the private sector, I think it's important that the health of these institutions need to be kept in mind. Otherwise, there's going to be a breakdown of the whole system. Unfortunately, and I think this is a very important factor, this has not been taken into account by the government, either intentionally or unintentionally. And when I say the health of the private sector, I think the financial health is something very important. And this actually needs to be looked at. The packages offered by Ayushman Bharat, I was part of a committee by the government of Karnataka, we did a costing. And this shows that the actual cost of procedures, we have chosen 20 procedures, and the Ayushman pays only about 25% of that. So there's a huge, huge gap. Subsequently, two other agencies did the costing along with the All India Institute and with the Niti Aayog, and one by the IMA. All the three studies were uniform in the fact that the reimbursements by the government were only 25 to 30% of the actual cost. And I think this needs to be looked at. And this will be a major obstacle if as we try to make Ayushman a pan-India phenomena where everybody would be benefited. I think a very important factor is that the costing has to be done. It has to involve all stakeholders. And on that basis, I think we can take this forward. The other issue is when we have been talking to the state governments in various states, they tell us very frankly that we don't have money. So in Karnataka, they've come up with a little, what we say is a little innovative. The government has said that the above poverty line patients can pay the rack rate, and that way can subsidize the treatment of the poor patient. So this is something that we need to consider. So in summation, I think there are three or four points which are very important. One is that the spending, the percentage of the GDP which is going to be spent by the government has to improve markedly. And I think this has come home greatly in this pandemic. I think this is something very important. We've been talking about this. I hope this is implemented. Number two, I think medical reforms have already started. There is a huge shortage of medical professionals. And I think this is something which has to be addressed. There is no point having a 500-bedded government hospital with 80% specialists sorted, because then it's good as having a very ineffective structure. I think there has to be transparency and accountability both from the private sector and the public sector. I think one of the weaknesses that we have at the present time is that the public sector is not accountable, is not transparent. And we have examples. We have Nimans in Bangalore, we have Jayadeva in Bangalore, we have Omni Institute. So it's not that it can't be done. So I think this is a second very important factor which has to be looked at. Transparency also in the private sector, because ultimately it's the patient who is the most important. And I think I'll come back with this costing again. I think this is a very, very important pillar. Neutral costing done by all the stakeholders, that could be the basis. Without that, the Ayushman Bharat may not be the success that it could be. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much, Dr. Alex. So I'll give you a little background of the context that I come from and from what we've heard as well. The wellness centers seem to be a great star within the sky that needs to be focused on. And, you know, sort of, I come from an engineering background. So first building these is something that, will become really important with dry and modular technologies, surely building the facilities first. Before we break into a round of rebuttal for 6 or 8 minutes, I think the second point also as a context that I'd like to make is that training, like the IT sector has grown, we will have to be able to train people as, you know, sort of the headquarters or the command center and then satellites operating out of it. And the last and final point for us to start rebuttals is what is technology going to play as a role in terms of connecting, in terms of linking, in terms of being able to create information banks that the entire network of primary, secondary, and tertiary care can feed into? So the floor is for everyone. Please, if you'd like to start with some rebuttals.
No, can I request, because I have to go to the operating room. Can I go first?
Please, sir.
Okay. So I think what you have heard from Joy, Alex, and me is the point that there is a wholehearted support for the Ayushman, the wholehearted support for the necessity to bring into the healthcare net the last few decades and provide that relief to them, which is their fundamental right. What has been said is that, yes, starting from the wellness center upwards, along with the sanitation and all the primary health and nutrition and all that stuff, which will help us to move forward to a healthier India. And basically the technology to link, that's what I was talking about, that you need technology to link the wellness centers to the specialist centers. Now, this is where I would like to make a suggestion. There is a lot of willingness, enthusiasm in the private sector to actually participate in the India healthcare stack. We need to bring together and break down the walls between private providers and government providers and be able to realistically think of Health India as one. And if we can actually string everything together on one stream, I think that we have enough infrastructure on the ground to provide 50% more care.
I think that we are
on the right track.
This question I want to sort of flip as well, and flip it to Dr. Alex. You know, we're talking about wellness centers and the infrastructure on the floor. Is the industry talking about how the physical building or how much of it will require to get built and how soon? Is it mapped region-wise or is it just a number in the air that everyone is trying to fulfill from their own little kitties?
The important thing to realize is, as was very correctly pointed out, the concept is very good. 150,000 wellness centers all over the country. I think infrastructure-wise, the government has already identified it. But the main...
Are we physically building? That's the big question, really.
No, I think more than the building, what is more important is the human resources. There is no point having a building without human resources. So that is where I think training and medical reforms come in very useful. I think recently there have been a slew of reforms, both for human resources, for technology. The National Board is now scaling up training of specialists. Technology, after 2 or 3 years of pushing the government, they finally opened up telemedicine. But the primary, if the wellness centers are to succeed, I think the infrastructure doesn't have to be built up. There are alternatives. It is mainly the human resources which needs to be looked after.
Can I flip this question to Joy, if you like, that, you know, Hinduja has been a flag bearer of healthcare within Bombay. In terms of training, are you all thinking of training people that can go to the smaller parts that spread out of Bombay? And whether the delivery of resources, like Dr. Alex is talking about, is something that, again, people are doing something on the ground with? Joy, sorry.
Absolutely, we are in that process, and that process has begun probably in 1981. In 1981, Hinduja Hospital came up with the first private nursing college. Okay, and since then, today, for the nursing education, we have undergraduate, postgraduate, and doctoral program in nursing. And we have DNB program in 26 different disciplines. It started with lesser number, but today we have reached into 26 disciplines. And you must appreciate that not being a typical teaching institution, we have adopted this and we are trying to meet the requirement of the country that how do you provide qualified, trained manpower. And we also recognize the requirement of allied health professionals. So under the leadership of Dr. Trehan, we have Health Sector Skill Council, which is, you know, working tremendously for the last few years to get the human resource which can complement the services of nurses and doctors in different areas, whether it is dialysis, operation theater, CSSD, lab, radiology, in all these areas. Because you must understand, in absence of them, nobody can give a real quality care to the population. So keeping that in the mind, today we run around 12 to 14 disciplines training program for those technicians also.
So if I can flip this question to Dr. Trehan. Dr. Trehan, we've spoken about technology as well. And, you know, remote intelligence to provide the quality at remote locations. One is training them. Second is ensuring that wherever they are going, the quality of delivery can still be mapped. What is remote intelligence playing as a role in terms of bringing this together?
So there are, we have to break it up into three. The immediate action that we need to take. So people are getting sick today. We can talk about, you know, what can we build in the future, but how are we going to, how are we going to treat them today? Because human lives will get lost if we wait for the ideal infrastructure to develop. So the interim solution is, first of all, ASAP, we identify the wellness center locations. Then we find, you know, we have 1.1 or 1.2 million ASHA workers at the village level. Every village has ASHA workers. Now, their capabilities today are a little limited. What we can do is they upscale their skills very quickly. We have already made from Health Sector Skill Council 10 modules. That if we can take them through this training of 10 modules, we can actually convert them to frontline health workers. So we need to empower them, we need to train them. So this is a big resource which we can use today. And then on top of that, we link them to all the hospitals, whether they are government, whether they are private, and we all volunteer for it. We all volunteer. If you give me 5 wellness centers to manage by IT link, where broadband is almost everywhere now, we can deliver care and advice to those people right now as we speak. So telemedicine, video conferencing has become a norm under this pandemic. Because this, if you are doing 100 consults from Vedanta on video call or tele calls, we are now doing over 500. We are doing 600-700 sometimes. So what I'm saying is that there is a lot of potential. But we need to string it all together and it will happen. And private sector is willing and ready and to be pulled into the system and help wherever we can in the interim as we build out the things that Alex and everybody has spoken about, that we need to build the manpower. We need to, because it takes 7 to 8 years for a doctor to become a specialist. So we can force multiply by our participation. Thank you very much. I'll have to sign off. Because I have to go to the operating room now. I have delayed it enough. Thank you very much.
Absolutely. Thank you so much, Dr. Trehan.
Bye.
Have a great operation. So, I mean, Dr. Alex and Joy, we've got a little bit less than one and a half minute. And Dr. Trehan is just left at the last minute. So I think there's enough of a conversation that we can have as well. In terms of, you know, sort of our generation in some context, data intelligence or dashboarding has become something that's the problem of many. What Dr. Trehan also ended with, and if you all could end with, you know, sort of a last thought as well, is that what are the low-hanging fruits? You know, sort of while at a larger scale, everything can be thought through and built out, what is the minimally viable product in small fragments that can start making an influence on the ground? And clearly wellness centers is something that's, you know, being, like we said, the star in the sky. So please, last thoughts, Dr. Alex and Joy.
Yeah, so I would tell you that I think what I think would be very important and very crucial as we go forward at all levels, this is a public-private partnership. And we have shown how it works in Karnataka. I think whatever we do will be hugely impactful. You don't need so many resources. You don't have to reinvent the world, the wheel. So I think that is something that we all need to focus on. And with that, we will have great results.
Thank you, Dr. Alex.
I feel the training and getting the human resources in place is going to be the most important, because they are going to be the backbone. And as very recently, there is a reform, what we have seen, a very welcome reform by the DNV board in terms of training super specialists in a typical non-teaching hospital kind of setup. If that becomes more and more, then for last several decades, we have told and we have cried and we have expressed our views that India needs more number of doctors and nurses. Probably we can bridge that gap slowly and steadily. And that is going to make a huge difference in the life of Indians.
Thank you so much, everyone. So final thing, build buildings, build people, build technology. Thank you all for coming. I'm sure I'll catch you again soon. Take care.
Thank you. Have a great day.
Thank you.
Thank you to our eminent speakers for an enlightening session. Let us move on to our next discussion, a roundtable discussion on Can India Achieve Universal Health Coverage? Our moderator for this session is Mr. Ravi Duggal, public health researcher. We also have Dr. Dilip Mavlankar, director, IIPH, Gandhinagar, Professor Anil Kumar, dean, School of Health Systems Studies, Tata Institute of Social Sciences, Dr. V. Ramankutty, Indian health economist, Emeritus Professor at SCTIMST, Kerala. I would now like to hand over the session to Mr. Ravi Duggal to take it ahead.
This roundtable on Can India Achieve UHC is part of the Healthcare and Infrastructure Summit, and as within the theme of government policies and funding. So I'm Ravi Duggal. I've been requested to moderate this session as well as make a brief presentation. And then we have three other members on the panel, Dr. Raman Kutty, Dr. Dilip Mavlankar, and Dr. Anil Kumar. So I'm kind of retired, and I function as an independent researcher and activist. My area of expertise is public health policy systems and financing, budgets, governance, social accountability. That's the areas I work on. And I have affiliations with the People's Health Movement and the People's Budget Initiative. So that's my core area of work. As regards the topic of discussion today, so my two slides I will share, and the others will follow with their slides. And then after 3 minutes each, then I will present certain issues put up on the screen, which we can then have an open discussion. So why UHC? It's become a global concern in the last few years. WHO has pushed it quite hard. In the context of SDGs also, it has emerged as an important initiative to see that everybody gets access to healthcare. I mean, nobody's left behind kind of thing. And this mandate actually began with the Alma-Ata Declaration in 1978, the Health for All strategy, which the WHO got most countries to sign. And many countries after that did do substantial work, like India's own first health policy post-independence kind of was announced in 1982 after this declaration. And the principle of universal access to healthcare probably began there, that healthcare should be pushed as a right. It should create equity. There should be equitable access. So nobody, there should be no segmentation of healthcare. And UHC, often in debates, one sees that UHC is often seen as a financing kind of strategy, but it is not a financing strategy alone. But also about health systems, human resources, equitable outcomes, and transparent and effective governance and accountability. So it's a much larger kind of strategy. It's a kind of a comprehensive approach. So universality is the key underlying feature. And at the core of UHC is the primary healthcare approach. So primary healthcare often is confused sometimes with primary health centers, which is not correct, because primary health centers is one dimension of first contact care that is provided to people. So it's a much larger thing. It includes referral care and basic referral care and access to higher levels of care. So it's the approach which is, I think, critical, what we call the primary healthcare approach. And I think that is at the core of UHC. And so what needs to be changed for UHC in India? Now, we know India is nowhere close to UHC. There are some states which you can say are reasonably well, which I'll talk about. So we need to politicize healthcare to make it a public good. I think that's an important starting point. So our health policy has to very strongly emphasize that healthcare is a public good. It cannot be left to the whims of the market. We need to build a strong primary healthcare foundation on which we construct that universal access healthcare system. And this would need immediate doubling of public spending. India is one of the lowest spenders where public investment is concerned in healthcare. So we are about 1.2% at the most of GDP that is being spent. And probably we are 8 or 9 from the bottom of the list of countries in terms of public spending as a ratio to GDP. If you look at some states like Mizoram and Sikkim, they do reasonably well in terms of providing primary health care. They spend over 4,000 rupees per capita. So Mizoram spends 4,200, Sikkim spends over 5,500, and Lakshadweep would spend almost 6,000 rupees per capita. And these are states which have robust primary healthcare systems, public functioning public system, whether it's the PHC or the CHC or district hospitals. Like a state like Mizoram perhaps doesn't have a teaching hospital. So that is a major kind of setback that they have. So they do have a budget to send people to various other states to access super speciality and tertiary care. The other issue that we need to deal with is we need to remove segmentation of healthcare. So you have healthcare for central government employees called the CGHS scheme, for industrial workers, we have the ESIC, and other social insurance programs for different segments of the population. So that kind of divides it and it creates certain privileges. So CGHS and defense services, for example, they are spending 8,000 rupees per capita on healthcare, which is huge compared to the national average of 1,700 rupees per capita on general healthcare. So this kind of segmentation is a barrier to realize universal access to healthcare. We need to rein in the private sector. Now, India has a huge private sector. We can't do away with it, but we need to find ways to regulate it and also to use it for public benefit. So that is something. So for example, taking the NHS example from UK. So you in NHS, the GPs are not employees of the NHS. They are kind of contracted in to provide healthcare services to a listed population, which is covered, families which are covered by them. And they provide the first level care and also do the referrals. So without a GP's referral, you can't access higher levels of care. So or Canada kind of buys beds in private hospitals in Canada when it is not a public hospital. So there are different models in which the private sector can be reined in. I strongly feel that we need to say no to insurance, private insurance in healthcare, and the PMJAY and its various state clone models, because we need to strengthen the public health system and provide the hospital care largely through the public system by strengthening district hospitals and making them teaching hospitals, so that people who are educated in these district hospitals are more likely to stay back in the district and not migrate out. And finally, I think in terms of governance and accountability, the community-based monitoring and planning strategy, which was part of the NRHM, which failed in most states, but in Maharashtra has shown that it can work. That is something which can build bottom-up accountability with local level decision making and planning. So I think these are some of the points I wanted to raise. So now we can move on to Raman. So please introduce yourself and add your points.
Yeah, I'll share my screen. This is just a title. I'm Raman Kutty. I retired from the Achyutamayanam Center for Health Science Studies, which is a public health school attached to Sri Chitra Tirunal Institute for Medical Sciences and Technology. I am a pediatrician by training, but I'm more interested in public health, so I have been working in public health for a long time. I also been part of an NGO called Health Action by People, which is currently I am the chairman, though not the director. I used to be the senior professor and head of Achyutamayanam Center. And also for 1 year I was an emeritus professor. Currently I'm officially the research head at Amla Cancer Research Center in Thrissur. My main research interests are health policy, chronic disease epidemiology, epidemiological transition, generally the area of health and development, which covers most of what we are now talking about. And I have only one slide which I've prepared, which is basically, I agree with most of the points that Ravi has raised, and these are the things that I think we should be talking about. And in as has been pointed out, UHC has been a recurring theme in many of the policy documents, especially the health policy documents. In various ways, they have talked about universal access. More recently, it has been renamed as UHC, universal health coverage, and there has been a debate on what how coverage differs from care and all that. So I'm not going into all that. But I think the route seems to be a little not very clear. They have the policy documents have suggested some things, but it is questionable if you do an analysis whether those things will really lead to universal health coverage or even universal health care. There are conflicting interests, the state and the center, there is not very clear who leads. Because most of the programs and the initiatives, the money is with the center, so they are able to kind of influence the policy very much. But according to the constitution, the state has a very large say in the health sector. So this creates some conflicts, especially in some states like my state, where the state has gone in for a decentralized model. And last 25 years, the health institutions have been with the panchayats and the local bodies. So that creates a conflict with because when you have the same pattern imposed from the center, whether the panchayat has any autonomy to change that is a big issue. And unfortunately, the staff is still with the state government in Trivandrum, so they also have a conflict with the panchayat. So all these things have not been resolved even after a long time. So this is something which all these policy documents have not really addressed. And the varying levels of health sector infrastructure and achievement in the various states is also very important. As Ravi pointed out, there are some states which have been investing a lot in health and they created their own models. And if you take Tamil Nadu, for instance, they are doing reasonably well with their own initiatives. Kerala has generally done well, partly because of the glory of past achievements in education. And but Kerala does face a problem of a huge private sector. So the question of how the private sector is going to be integrated into this is a big thing which nobody has really looked into, or rather no final say on this has been emerging. And the currently proposed Ayushman Bharat and PMJAY seems to think that incorporating private sector more and more and going the insurance way is going to be the route towards universal health coverage. And of course, I think many people have expressed their doubts, and I also share the concerns that the the insurance route may not be the best because it might lead to a lot of moral hazard and other things, money not being used in the proper way. So that may not be the best alternative. That may also lead to inadequacy of coverage for certain types of certain sections of the population. But one good point I think about the PMJAY is that they have at least on paper emphasized the primary health care and the family health centers and all that. Though in principle, that is in principle, but how it works out in practice is we have yet to see. In Kerala, at least, they have taken up this initiative and started to develop the primary health centers into family health centers, which is a good initiative. So there are some models in some states which we have to look at, and maybe we have to build on that towards a national model. So that's all I would say at this point. Thank you.
Thanks, Raman. Can we move to Dilip?
Yeah. Thank you very much. Let me share my screen. I am Dilip Mabrankar. I am the current director at Indian Institute of Public Health in Gandhinagar. One word about IIPHG. IIPHG, Indian Institute of Public Health, is a unique partnership between Public Health Foundation and Gujarat government, set up in 2007 to strengthen multidisciplinary public health education, training, and research. And IIPHG became the first public health university of India in 2015 through State Act. And since then, we have been offering Master of Public Health and Master of Hospital Administration, 2-year full-time programs. And before that, we were offering with other institutions postgraduate program in public health management, which is a 1-year program. And then we also do short-term training programs for the state governments, NGOs, and other sectors, as well as we do a lot of research through our faculty, where about half of the time is spent by each faculty on research. My background, I did MBBS in 1981 and then MPH in 1983 and Doctorate of Public Health in 89. Worked at National Institute of Health in US for a year as a visiting fellow. And following that, I came back and joined Indian Institute of Management in Ahmedabad and worked there as a faculty for 20 years. And since 2012, I am the director of Indian Institute of Public Health. My main areas of research are on public health management, maternal child health, reproductive health, emergency obstetric care. I have been part of the mission steering group of National Rural Health Mission for the first 5 years. And have been on various government committees in the state of Gujarat and in the central level. And that's how I developed some understanding of UHC. Now, I want to focus on how can we achieve universal health care. Our rural health system, which was set up since independence, was a step in the right direction. When the British left, we had only the urban health services, and it was recognized then, and we started developing, following Gore Committee report, development of primary health care in rural areas. After that, very early on after independence, we developed ESIS, Employee State Insurance Program, for the organized sector healthcare, organized sector employees healthcare needs. And that was one of the most progressive and comprehensive healthcare program, even though it may not be running in the best possible way. After long years, then the Labor Ministry developed another program, RSBY, Rashtriya Swasthya Bima Yojana, which became a sort of, in some sense, starting of the changing of the game. Rather than health ministry, the Labor Ministry said it health is an important issue and all laborers must have some kind of, or all workers must have some kind of health coverage. Following that, and that had 30,000 rupees of coverage, the aim was to cover 1/3 of India. Following that, now Ayushman Bharat PMJY has come in over last 2-3 years, which aims to cover 40% of Indians and with 5 lakhs of coverage. Now, all of this is still not universal healthcare, but it is moving in that direction. And what I see, the easiest way to move further in that direction would be to expand PMJY or similar coverage to about 80% of the population rather than 40%. Thinking that top 20% of India's population can look after their own health through private mechanisms. The other thing is it would have to have outpatient services and diagnostic services. Because currently it is most of the health insurance, including PMJY, covers only the inpatient or serious sickness which requires inpatient care and procedure. So outpatient care, which is the large burden of ill health as well as large burden on finances, is not covered. So that needs to be included. Now to do all of this, we have to work with the private sector. And Ravi talked about how Britain could use or is still using private general practitioners to provide outpatient care. We could also think of similar mechanisms. We have lots of private doctors in general practice which can provide such outpatient care. For doing that, we need to increase the public expenditure. Now, unfortunately, in India, the discussion on increasing of public expenditure has been going on for 20 years. And if all the words and written words and spoken words were money, we would have already reached 20%. So much of has been said. But actually, when it comes to putting money, somehow all governments are very, very, I don't know, stingy or not willing to put in, or all kinds of reasons they find why it cannot happen. So I think that is one of the underlying things. We need to put in more money. Second is money itself will not solve the problem. We have to think of how to better manage the health services, how to better manage our directorates and commissionerates and other mechanisms which govern the health services. So how do we have more professionally trained and public health strengthening via public health cadre on the lines of Indian Administrative Service? Maybe it could be provincial administrative services, because public health is the other side. So far we are only talking of sickness care, but what about prevention? What about clean water, air, etc., which are social determinants of health? It should be part of UHC. And finally, we have to keep the patients in the center, focusing on quality and cost-effective treatment. If we do that, I think then we will be able to think of moving in the direction of UHC. Thank you.
Thanks, Dilip. That was good and quite comprehensive. Anil, your turn.
To begin with, myself is Anil Kumar. Okay. So, I am currently working with the School of Health System Studies at the Tata Institute of Social Sciences. I have been working here for a long time. The school, in a different form as a Department of Health Services Studies, began in 1981. And since 1983, it is running different master programs, particularly started with Masters in Hospital Administration, Masters in Health Administration. And subsequently, it has started to other programs, Master of Public Health in Social Epidemiology and Master of Public Health in Health Policy, Economics, and Finance. Two MPhil and PhD programs have started in 2008 2008 and later in 2012 on health services management and in public health. In addition to that, two long running PG diploma in hospital administration and for the past 5 years in healthcare quality management. Other than that, there are other short term programs at the request of various agencies. Also some diploma in public health programs with CMC Vellore. Then we have several research programs, projects funded by various agencies. This is what is happening at the School of Health System Studies. I'll move on to the what at least in brief I have to say about UHC. UHC strategies, Ayushman Bharat Health and Wellness Centers as the two major strategies which has been initiated by the central government is making progress. Yes, I think as the previous speakers also have in a way in the short span of time pointed out that the conceptualization of UHC along the line of leap in financial and it is something much beyond that. And the second point is related to the understanding of the concepts of what is meant by universal health coverage, whether it is a universal coverage of essential care or whether it is a universal coverage of comprehensive care. It appears to be that over the years, the emphasis has been at least let us at least try to find, I mean, provide the essential care to all. But even in that front, we are really not kind of progressing the way we want to progress. We have been progressing. Also, we are expected to have the number of health and wellness centers that is 150,000 by 2022. And we are somewhere about 50,000 health and wellness centers, which is one third of what we are supposed to be achieving by 2022. So, but then still there is a possibility of achieving it, but provided that we need to kind of increase the pace, which actually started as a very rapid kind of a level, but has somehow reduced a little bit in the past, not just related to COVID, even before that it has actually started to slack slightly. So my hope is that it will, the health and wellness center also have been functioning, but we really do not know how effective the functioning of this health and wellness center is. I think the Niti Aayog is currently initiating a evaluation study to find out at least wherever it is functioning, how effective they are functioning. And though as Professor Ramanguti was saying, everything is looking good on paper, but in practice, how it actually will it actually move beyond what used to be the primary health care center or what primary health center or sub center? The functioning will it actually? How far it is going to be beyond the functioning of the primary health center? I mean, the in terms of practical way. That is one thing. The second was also has been mentioned, health financing. Now, how we are going to meet the increasing financial burden is something we have to think about. A third part is, again, this also has been mentioned by more than one speaker, primarily related to the role of private sector. It appears that the private sector is a kind of, while in theory, public sector may be the dominant provider, but in practice, public sector is the prominent dominant, as we all will agree. And it is increasingly becoming dominant with not much kind of, while we say that the role of the state is to regulate the private sector, we encourage private sector, which is very good, but then we are, I don't know how we are able to regulate private sector, and also how far we are able to critically and constructively engage with private sector is something I think we like there is no final say, and there is not even a clear understanding that whether we will ever be able to deal with private sector for the public good is something we need to again consider. A fourth point is related to what is, when we are talking about a kind of a loosely regulated private sector and its growth, unprecedented in an unprecedented way. Now, what does that actually, what is the model that we are actually thinking? We are saying that the competition will increase efficiency and therefore the public sector will kind of compete with the private sector and will provide services without any increase in the kind of resources that are available to them? Or is it that we are actually thinking that the private public sector health services will disappear? So what is the role of the public health sector? I think that the role of private sector is not, other than profit making, for providing public health services, what is the role of public private sector is not sure. And what is going to be the role of public sector in the future is also not clear. And a fifth point, which is related to very critical, and which I, especially when I am coming from a kind of an institution where education is also done in the public health sector. So one is related to human resource health. How are we going to meet the challenges? We all have, at various forums, we have discussed that there is a dearth in a way of meeting appropriate human resources. We may have human resources per se trained in the area of medicine, in terms of social sciences, in terms of paramedical sciences, but then how are they appropriately equipped to meet the resources, the challenges that are emerging for the country? What are the implications now? What are the implications of education health? So are we having our education, medicine, paramedical, public health, and the health service administration, including hospital services, are in the right direction? A second is that about what Professor Malvankar was saying about public health, whether it is in the IAS cadre or even below that, why you still do not have a cadre of public health? And what is actually, what is that actually is preventing, and why are we at the conceptual argument level of initiating a public health cadre at the national level and in some of the states? And why, even when some of the states have taken initiative to institute a public health cadre, why is that there are so much of a kind of impediments that are surrounding along with that? And and along with that, we need to equip the community level workers, and the role of vocational education, that is particularly with respect to the recent national education policy and the kind of multidisciplinary education and vocational and skill related education, and what these skills have to do with the community level health working. I think with this I'll stop, and then as the discussion progresses we can thank you.
Thank you, Anil. Okay, so I think we've done a great job in terms of, together we have captured all the entire spectrum of around the UHC debate, and I think we've covered a very large range of issues. Yeah, so before I do that, I realized that I did not introduce myself fully in terms of my own personal background. I come from sociology academically. I've also done management. And apart from that, I've worked mostly in the NGO sector, working with NGOs, including donor NGOs. So I've worked initially with Foundation for Research in Community Health, then Sehat, ActionAid International Budget Partnerships, USAID, et cetera. And I've also been visiting faculty at Achyuta Menon Center as well as TISS off and on, and did a very brief stint of about a year or so as a national advisor on health financing in the Ministry of Health in Delhi, Nirman Bhavan. So this has been my personal background. Worked mostly in the NGO sector, and have been very active with various social movements on both health, social security, and related issues. But I think in the context of providing universal access to healthcare with equity, we would need to resort to some form of legislation, constitutional amendment, etc., like it happened in the case of education, for example. So that will be necessary. If not a constitutional amendment, definitely a strong law on the right to healthcare. This whole strategy of, I think, in Ayushman Bharat, there's the positive thing, which I think all of us have indicated, the health and wellness center concept, I think, basically to strengthen primary healthcare. And Kerala has done that to a fair extent with their family health centers. Tamil Nadu has done some kind of district level pilots in few of the districts where they have added to the sub centers an extra A&M, as well as where possible some non-allopathic doctors who can provide curative care, first contact care, so that that kind of care is available closer to people's residence. So health and wellness center is a good concept. We have also done this kind of piloting in Chhattisgarh. I've been involved in that. And in Chhattisgarh, we've developed a strategy how to move towards UHC, which includes the foundation of which would be the health and wellness center. So that's a good concept to strengthen primary health care if it is provided with the resources that is needed, because we need anything close to 30 lakh rupees for each health and wellness center per year. If when that kind of investment is nowhere in sight, and even the budgets have not made that allocation. Then we need to strengthen public hospitals by making district hospitals as teaching hospitals. See, human resources is a major problem. And in accessing, in strengthening the public health system. So if we convert all our district hospitals, not on a PPI, public part, private initiative mode, which the Niti Aayog is talking about, but actually strengthen them as public institutions by converting them into teaching hospitals, I think you'll have human resources available more locally within the district, because there'll be less migration then. And also, I think the state needs to resort to some form of compulsory public service of nurses, of doctors, of managers, etc., who should work in the public system to provide health care, so that will automatically, every year there'll be an outturn, and that will add on to. So like we are producing 50,000-60,000 doctors, each MBBS doctors each year. I mean, enough to have two in each of our PHCs, which exist today. So that can create a huge resource, and likely a large proportion of them will stay back into the public system. We've talked about the private sector, how do we use it for public benefit, and it needs regulation, and so all that needs to be done. So private sector is a very large component of our healthcare system, and somehow we need to start working with them for public benefit, and the state will have to create a regulatory mechanism for that. And finally, we need to commit larger budgetary resources, as Dilip also said, 3-4% of GDP, something which we need to move towards. A lot of it should come through taxes, but I think I would add one point here, that instead of the PMJY JAY model, I think what we need to do is to strengthen social insurance. So make, for example, make ESIS as the fulcrum on which you build the social insurance thing. ESIS today covers only something like 15% of the workforce. So I think you need to build on that so that you can cover, bring in the informal sector into the ESIS kind of social insurance thing. And that itself will bring in more resources, because we all know that ESIS, even with just covering 3.5 crore workers, is actually it's a cash-rich organization with reserves of 80,000 crores, of which 50,000 crores are free reserves, and they have gone into medical education, which is not their mandate. So they've set up medical colleges, nursing colleges, etc., which they can't run now. So huge public investment has got wasted. So I think these are the issues that we would need to deal with. So now I open this discussion. So anyone can pitch in and make their points on any of these or other issues that you feel are important.
Yeah,
Yes.
Ravi, can I add?
Yeah, sure.
One thing which I spent about 2 weeks in Germany about 15, 20 years ago to understand their social health insurance model, which is quite different and good. What they emphasized in the class quite a bit was the whole concept of solidarity, that everybody has to have similar benefits, even though they may not be economically equal. Now, unfortunately, that in Indian society, which is hierarchical, so divided, so what should I say, sahib oriented, is I'm not seeing it. And to really say, so in one of the committees I had mentioned in UHC report, they were saying, what package should the last person have? My only answer was, what package the prime minister had, the last person should have the same package.
Yeah, that's so
the same anatomy, same physiology. Somehow they were shocked. They said, well, what is this you are saying? Last person. So I think it's a big problem of mindset change. Saying what and for which political activism of the public health people, not activism, at least engagement is required. We need to talk to our MPs, MLAs, and because they are the people who will decide the sort of financing and recovery. Second is we have to have some kind of parallel track working with the communities, trade unions, other organizations, farmers organizations, to raise this issue as a social issue for which political answers and financing answers have to come. So that was my 2 cent wisdom. Maybe others can add. Thank you.
Yeah, I think that's an important point you've raised. And just to give an example, I mean, the pre-monsoon session of Parliament, the committees were meeting, and the Labour Committee very emphatically has said that we need to now see that ESIS doesn't continue to make the same mistakes, and we need to extend this to the non-formal sector, to the informal sector. So they are thinking on those terms. So I think if that happens, that will be a very good move forward. Yes, Raman, you want to?
Yeah, I completely agree with this, that the segmentation of packages is certainly not giving the right message. You know, we should everybody should have access to the same kind of facilities, and at least, you know, that should be the principle on which it is built. I would just add one point that which I made earlier also, that I think we have different states and different problems and different levels of development or infrastructure. So the policy should be broad enough to accommodate different models, for instance, provided the goal is the, you know, the achievement or what we are going towards is quite the same, the universal health coverage. I think that's the only point I want to make.
Anil?
Yeah, I think we have pretty much covered many of the issues related to UHC. I just wanted to emphasize on one point, is related to quality of services. Now we have been, when we are talking about the quantity, what is going to suffer is quality. On the one hand, we are not sure whether we will achieve the quality, and when are we going to achieve is one thing. At the same time, what is going to happen to the quality of the services is one thing. And as it is rightly said that the last person should have the same package as the prime minister has, is a very kind of very correct way of kind of viewing that how the UHC should be kind of rolled out in during over the course of time. That is one thing. And then the way it has been, even the all the models is actually kind of not aiming at having a universalization of coverage. It is actually still hovering around 20%. How we are going to make it to 80% is a kind of a huge challenge, especially the considering the current situation that we are going. How we are going to, when we are going to reach that 80%, is going to be kind of seriously considered. And of course, human resources for health is going to be a biggest challenge that needs to be dealt with in this. I think with that, I will stop this. My
point. Yeah, human resources is important. The thing is that it's not that we're not producing enough human resources. I mean, we produce 60 to 70,000.
So that's the distribution. Hello. Yeah, you're. I think your voice is like jarring.
Okay, is it okay now?
Can you say something? Now it is proper. If you could just repeat your last line.
I was just responding to the human resource issue that it's not a question of that we're not producing enough human resources, especially doctors. We're producing more than 1 lakh doctors if you take the non-allopath also into account. So it's just the question is of distribution. So where are they located? Or how many are migrating to other countries also? So these are larger concerns. So we don't have to set up many more medical colleges in the private sector. That's not the solution. And so if we strengthen the existing district hospitals as teaching hospitals, I think we can move far ahead in providing good secondary and tertiary care also, along with the health and wellness centers, which all of us have kind of said. So I would like to close this with the example of Chhattisgarh that we have worked on recently, just to highlight the importance. We worked out a model in Chhattisgarh where the Chhattisgarh government will have to devote at least 3,800 rupees per capita to provide good. And what will that include? At the health and wellness center, another A&M, instead of one A&M, two A&Ms, one male worker, and one non-allopathic doctor. Chhattisgarh had this BSc health sciences graduate course, which had been stopped through the pressure of IMA. But so there are enough people there already trained, something like 1,200 or 1,400 are already there. So they can be used for that. Chhattisgarh also has 800 unemployed dentists, which can be used as a doctor. And incidentally, I met some of them. They had taken public health training at Achyuta Menon Center. So there's no dearth of human resources. The question of how you deploy them effectively. And I think strengthening health and wellness centers, which Chhattisgarh has now, I think, already done it in some 8 districts, and it's expanding gradually. Let's see how the results come out. They do have an issue of getting specialists in that state because they don't have, I think they have just 2 or 3 medical colleges. And a lot of people migrate out, but I think they need to put in effort to bring in specialists. So that they can provide good tertiary care also within the state. Thanks to IDAC for hosting this event.
Thank you all very much.
Thank you. Thank you.
Okay, thanks.
Thank you to our esteemed speakers. Let us move on to our next discussion, which is a panel discussion on nursing financial health of hospitals. The moderator for this session is Dr. Preet Matani, Director, PricewaterhouseCoopers Private Limited. We also have Mr. Pradeep Jaisingh, Founder and Chairman, HealthStart, Mr. Jitendra Haryan, CEO, Jaslok Hospital, and Dr. Vivek Desai, Founder, HOSMAC. I would now like to hand over the session to Dr. Preet Matani, and he will take the lead.
Ladies and gentlemen, a warm welcome to all of you for the panel discussion on nursing financial health of hospitals. I am Dr. Preet Matani, Director Healthcare Advisory of PwC, and will be your moderator for this session. It is my pleasure to welcome the esteemed members of this panel, Mr. Pradeep K. Jaisingh, who is the founder and chairman of HealthStart, India's leading healthcare incubator, and also the founder director of International Oncology, a chain of cancer care centers. Dr. Vivek Desai, who is the founder and managing director of HOSMAC, and a veteran of the healthcare industry with around 3 decades of experience. And Mr. Jitendra Haryan, the CEO of Jaslok Hospital, Mumbai. The topic of today's discussion is very relevant in the current context, where everyone who you speak to thinks that hospitals are benefiting from the COVID crisis, whereas in fact, hospitals are facing an existential challenge and facing difficulties in paying salaries with their high fixed costs. The insufficient government funding and inefficient spends of the allocated amount have turned the government into a payer from a provider, with 74% of the hospitals in the country owned by the private sector. Healthcare has also been one of the key employment generators, being the 4th largest employer in India, with every bed added creating 5 direct and 25 indirect jobs. However, it still hasn't received as much attention as other sectors from the government. If we have to go from 1.1 beds per 1,000 population to 1.8 beds per 1,000 population in the next 10 years, we would need to add an additional 1.2 million beds in that 10-year time frame with an investment of around $4 billion USD every year. However, the returns in this sector have been low, with an ROCE of around 7.2% for 20 key hospitals. This has dampened the appetite amongst the key stakeholders for investment. Also, this is a healthcare crisis, and there hasn't been any mention of the healthcare sector in the stimulus that the government has announced. My first question to all the panelists would be, what are the areas that are impacting the industry, and how should we look at the challenges faced currently, and what could have been done by the government to attract, what could be done by the government to attract investment? Mr. Jaisingh?
Yes, sure. Thank you. Thank you, Preeta. That's a wonderful background that you have said. And clearly, I think, unlike the, uninformed perception, hospital sector, healthcare sector, certainly facing tremendous challenges, and particularly the delivery systems, all the hospitals really facing this crisis induced by the pandemic. And so multiple things can be, of course, done in the current context, as well as the overall context of attracting healthcare investment, given some of the parameters that you really mentioned here. I think we have really not been incentivizing the investment into the sector. There are some very obvious sort of incentives that the sector can look forward to. There has been continuous requests for some tax holidays, as well as duty structure rationalization. Specifically, if I were to talk about cancer care, then the radiation therapy and other oncology equipment still attracts duties where it should actually be not only reduced, but some additional incentives given to the people who are setting up infrastructure in this sector. So this is just an example, but there are multiple other things to attract investment in tier two and tier three cities that can be done.
Thanks. Thanks, Mr. Jaisingh. Dr. Desai, your views on the topic?
Yeah, so I think, this pandemic has hit us in a manner which no one earlier guessed, you see. Even the best of the country's healthcare infrastructure could not, face this. You can take that in Europe as well as in United States. India probably, fared a little better due to the prolonged, lockdown that we did, hoping that we would, improve the infrastructure in tier two, tier towns before, we open them up. Now, part success, I may say, did go the way it was supposed to be. But the problem that came to the fore was that we suddenly realized that government, which was thinking to take a positioning as a payer, by launching the Ayushman Bharat scheme, they sort of thought that they would become a payer and the private sector should invest more into healthcare. Now that suddenly became a problem. Even in big cities like Mumbai, we were not able to cope up, with whatever came, and we had to set up these jumbo centers and things like that. So I think going forward, the government will need to think very, very carefully as to are they going to rely completely on, private healthcare to give healthcare, or they would have to invest in infrastructure themselves also. So this budget actually, there was this viability gap funding, structure which they came up with. And we were part of that with NatHealth, where we had done that. So the idea was, whether we could push private investment in tier three towns, not only tier two, with some kind of a structure which encourages people to invest. So government comes in, gets you the land, maybe also part funding in the infrastructure. We worked on a 100-bed module, at that point in time. And then whether some viability gap funding is also provided for the initial 3 to 4 years when hospitals struggle during the gestation, bit of it. So the government will have to think really, really carefully as to how to do it. Now, coming to the fact that how does one deal with this immediate problem of pandemic? So, though there has been a lot of you know, private sector criticism, but I would say that, you know, the private sector has stood up. I don't think that, you know, we've not been able to contribute. We have contributed, you know, fairly good. In fact, the government should probably now come forward and release some of the backlog, you know, especially in insurance schemes, you know, so be it Ayushman Bharat or state-sponsored or CGHS or, you know, the armed forces. They have, all of these have, you know, a lot of pending money which needs to be released. So if they release that, I'm sure, you know, Jitendra would be able to tell us better. I think that would help because cash flow has come under tremendous stress. Projects which were launched maybe about 3-4 years ago have to struggle with the problem of low occupancy, interest burden and principal repayment. So it's going not going to be easy for those kinds of, you know, so they will have to come out with schemes to help hospitals in different buckets, you know, the smaller ones differently, the established private ones probably a little bit better off because debt is very low, and the new entrants which came and invested. So government will have to do something about it pretty much quickly, apart from things which Pradeep said in terms of duty reductions and exemptions.
Yeah, very relevant points, Dr. Desai. And the government spends just 1% of its GDP. I mean, they've always stated that they want to go up to 2.5% by 2024-25. But I think that you know, the current crisis has highlighted the need to increase the spend that the government does on an urgent basis, as you highlighted.
Correct.
Thanks. Jitendra, your views on the subject?
Yeah, so thank you, first of all, for having me here on the panel. And I would just like to build on what Mr. Sunit and Dr. Vivek Desai have said. So, see, fundamentally, you know that, I mean, to run the big hospitals need a lot of cash. The hospitals are quite heavy on the fixed expenses and need continuous investment into technology and infrastructure. So you need, you know, cash to pay salaries, CMC costs, electricity expenses, and also need to invest, replace, upgrade the technology. So, you know, you need a lot of cash to run the hospital. So that's the fundamental. On the other side, there is not much margin in the hospital. So we will be short on the EBITDA. Even the good, the best of the hospitals, you know, the managing PNLs would have not more than 15 or perhaps 20% EBITDA. And then you, from that, you have to invest into technology and, you know, then perhaps distribute or, you know, dividend, etc. to your investors. So that's how typically the PNL is of the hospital. The crisis like this, when it comes to the healthcare sector, obviously, where the occupancy is below 50%, I think in Mumbai, one time it touched about 25%. You can imagine that there can be a shortfall because you have to still pay the salary, you have to still pay the EMC expenses, and you have to think that, you know, something, you know, goes wrong with the machinery, you have to think again, you have to reflect. So it's not really a good situation, you know, for the healthcare and the hospital sector. On the other hand, there is not much research and development happening in the healthcare sector, especially in the, you know, the medical equipment segment. So we have to import all the machinery from, you know, XYZ countries, and it costs. As an example, if you have to buy MRI, it will cost in excess of 8-9 crores, and if you want high-end specs, then you have to spend in excess of 10 crores. Now, when you have to spend so much in the machinery, you cannot have 2,000, 3,000 rupees cost for MRI. It will be in excess of 8,000, 7,000. So healthcare becomes, again, expensive. And relatively, you cannot have higher margin also on this cost. So the investment case for the healthcare is not so lucrative. So that is not, you know, that is the healthcare where it stands at the moment. Now, from the context of the pandemic and the financial crisis, what government can do to aid to address the situation and to sort of, get more attention to healthcare from outsiders in terms of investors, there can be certain short-term and the long-term measures that can be, you know, thought upon. So first of all, from the short-term measures point of view, I think the current situation of the cash crisis needs to be addressed. Where is the cash coming from at the moment? If the hospitals have built on the internal accruals, perhaps they would be needing, you know, from that. And last 6 months now, initially, you know, we were thinking that this pandemic would be over in 2 months, 3 months. I had heard from the experts, so-called experts, that it's going to peak in April and will, you know, sort of slow down in May, and from June, July, you know, life will be normal. It never happened. Yeah, so we were expecting it to sort of, you know, normalize in June, July. It never happened. So hospitals are sustaining, you know, with that kind of situation for for last 6 months, and it's not easy, and it's not going to be easy because we still, you know, feel that we have not peaked. So, and the normal occupancies, I would say, on the non-COVID is about 50% of the normal, 50-60% at the max. So, you know, so government will have to really think upon this and how to support this sector. So what can be done in the short term situation is that the hospitals who are facing the cash crunch can be provided the bridge financing, the overdraft, the working capital with the government backing. I think it's necessary that you know, they have that sort of perspective towards this sector. The other can be done is that, you know, central government can sort of expedite the, you know, wherever the tax refunds are due to the sector, that can be expedited so that actually the cash starts coming. And we have that situation, for example. Then, you know, there is another avenue where, you know, there can be relaxation in the CSR rules. So the companies who have obligation to sort of spend on the CSR, the healthcare actually can be made into sort of a paid sector or a favorite sector where if they invest into healthcare in the, say, capital estates or machinery, then they can actually get double benefit. For example, they can claim depreciation, they can show the assets in their books, show the depreciation, and also can set off that obligation, you know, against their CSR. So this is another thing that can be done. From the long-term perspective, again, I mean, there are many things that can be done, but just few to name, I would say that, you know, first of all, I think there should be transparency built into the sector where the government can also take steps into, you know, sort of having some guidelines for fair pricing on certain areas. Because when you look at the hospital bills, you will see that, you know, it's sort of, you can't compare the two bills. I mean, you will see different cases in two hospital bills. So therefore, people in general feel that there is no transparency, and that needs to be sort of driven towards. So that is number one. The other is that the medical insurance has to be sort of promoted. So maybe GST can be relaxed on the medical insurance, because more and more, you know, the insurance you have insured people, then healthcare sector would be supported. The other is medical tourism also can be promoted as such. You know, by expediting medical visas and also giving sort of preferential treatment to the tourists who come for medical reasons, that can be done. Also, the implementation of, like Dr. Desai said, that of this subsidized schemes such as CGHS and government-sponsored insurance, they should be followed, implemented in the true spirit. I mean, hospitals need not wait for 4 months, 6 months to get their money. I think that will also ease out on the cash flows of the hospitals. So I think these are some things that can be done. And of course, there is again a shortage of doctors and nurses in the sector, which is a big issue. And, you know, what comes to my mind is that currently we have about 300 plus hospitals which run these programs like DMB, etc. And they perhaps have bigger volumes than some of the medical colleges. So these hospitals can also be recognized to take undergrad programs such as MBBS. So that will also increase, you know, the number of doctors in the country without any additional investment.
Yeah, quite you know, valid points, Jitendra. And I think healthcare is a complex industry where, you know, costs are not well understood. I mean, people don't seem to appreciate the costs that go behind, you know, what hospitals need to incur, and that has been one of the major challenges facing the industry. Now, Mr. Jai Singh, I would like to, you know, since you have been associated with cancer care for a long time, would like to get your thoughts that in the current crisis, I mean, a lot of folks in tier 2, tier 3 cities couldn't access, you know, care in hospitals because, you know, there were no cancer care centers there. We are still far behind, you know, developed countries as well as developing countries in the number of LINACs that we have. We would have somewhere around 400 odd today, vis-a-vis, you know, something where a US and China would be much, much ahead of us. So just wanted to get your thoughts, besides, you know, the exemptions on tax that you were, on the infrastructure that you were highlighting, what are the other things that could be done to increase the penetration of cancer care centers in the country, in tier 2, tier 3 cities? The COVID crisis has set us back by at least a couple of years. And, you know, whatever growth phase that we were on in the oncology space has taken a temporary halt. What do you think would be the measures that the government should probably take to help cancer care centers? And are some of the rates that the government gives for the Ayushman Bharat and other schemes viable for hospitals?
Great question, Preet. I think you have highlighted a really, really important issue. Given the disease burden in cancer that we have in India and the rate at which it is growing, I think we are really sitting on a very, very major crisis here. But just to give you a perspective, when we set up our first cancer center here in 2009 timeframe, and both for diagnostic, the PET scan, as well as linear accelerators for radiation therapy, the dollar rupee exchange rate was 40. And so twofold, you know, hit that the cancer industry or oncology players are getting here in India. One is that the prices of these equipments, linear accelerators and, you know, PET scans and other infrastructure continues to be high. And then the exchange rate, dollar rupee exchange rate, you know, moving only in one direction, where now close to 74, and that has really made this entire investment requirement so high. Some of the points that Jitendra was highlighting earlier, that is a problem for not only hospitals, but people looking at cancer centers also. And then you take the problem to tier 2 and tier 3 cities, and therefore the capacity to pay in these cities being what it is, makes the economics of setting up a cancer center even more unattractive. And therefore, to ensure that we have the requisite number of cancer centers, requisite number of linear accelerators, I think the government has to come up with a more comprehensive sort of plan. If they would like more private sector participation in ensuring access to cancer care in these cities, tier 2 and tier 3 towns, then the government has to really participate and incentivize them, reduce their cost of capital, or government has to make at least the payment side more attractive. Some of the rates that the government has fixed, even for larger cities, just barely makes it viable given the volumes. If the volumes are large, then at least in the larger cities, the volume will make up for that. But that is not going to be the case in tier 2, tier 3 cities. So this is a huge problem we are looking at right now. Then, of course, the other point one of the colleagues mentioned here is that in areas like cancer care, the expertise challenge, the competence challenge is even higher. You go like 50 kilometers away from cities like Mumbai or Delhi, and the expertise for cancer is almost non-existent. The treating physicians misdiagnose cancer rampantly. A spinal tumor gets diagnosed as tuberculosis and things like that. And then availability of medical oncologists, radiation therapists, it's just absolutely next to nothing. Some amount of surgical expertise exists in district towns and all that, but those are not specialized. Those are not cancer-specific surgery expertise. So that is additional challenge that makes the problem even more critical. And so I'm really glad that you highlighted this area and something that I'm very, very passionate about. But the cancer care situation in India continues to be very, very difficult. And unless major steps are taken by the government and the incentive structure is created for the private sector, we are really looking at a continued sort of lack of availability and access to large number of patients. And the cancer burden continues to increase in India, unfortunately. And for next 10 years, 15 years or so, we are really looking at this demand supply gap unless something major is done very quickly.
Let's hope the government does something there, and you know, we can improve the penetration of cancer care centers in tier 2, tier 3 cities. And as you rightly highlighted, Mr. Jai Singh, manpower is a crucial thing. And coming to Mr. Jitendra, standalone private hospitals as well as chains of private hospitals, they have faced difficult times in this COVID crisis. I mean, they have had to keep their hospitals up and running, as well as, you know, many of their workers have gotten infected with COVID, and they have had to bear the cost of treatment for all their staff or support them during these difficult times. In addition, the government also decided to cap rates on quite a few things. I mean, they decided to control the COVID beds as well as the non-COVID beds. First, it was up to 80% of the non-COVID beds, and now they have relaxed it to 50% of the non-COVID beds. Now, is this viable for hospitals? And you know, what could have been better by the government to support hospitals in this difficult period?
Yeah. Okay. So basically, when the lockdown started from 23rd March, so you know, typically all the hospitals announced the shutdown of normal OPDs and only emergency work started was sort of kept open. So, and as I said earlier, that nobody knew that how long it will go on. So people thought that it perhaps a situation of a month or two, but we know the reality what it is. So, and what happened then, the occupancy dropped, as I said, to about 20-25% and still about 50%. So the first, the major challenge was that the work went down significantly in the 5-6 months. Another challenge was that the staff, you know, as I said, that, you know, was a major challenge, staff getting infected. And in the initial period, especially, so the effect of that was, you know, the direct and indirect both, because we had to do the contact tracing, you know, quarantine the connected staff and, put them in the hotels. Obviously, the available staff was reduced, going by that method. Then, the indirect was due to the fear, you know, the other staff would also sort of, you know, abstain from coming. So that, you know, in the initial period, the attendance dropped to almost about 15%, you know, of the normal. You can imagine that what was the situation. But, you know, as the learning curve was improving, I think things started normalizing. So today we have, you know, you can say that with this, again, the trend started about 1 to 1.5 months back. After that, again, the attendance improved. The other challenge was that, you know, due to this situation, there was certain costs also sort of came in new. Like, you know, we have to spend a lot of money. Sorry?
Pradeep sir's video.
Can I continue?
Sir, we can see walls only above you. If you could just adjust your...
Okay. Better?
Yeah. Yeah, a lot better. Thank you.
Okay, so the other major challenge was the increased, you know, variable costs, such as the costs on PPE and safety precautions. Then transport facilities, as I said, in the initial period that we had to have about 15 odd buses to get our staff to the hospital. Then the rental facilities also doubled because, you know, whatever hostels we had, due to social distancing, it reduced to half the capacity. And we had to look for other arrangements to sort of put them up. And that also increased the rental costs and again, the hotel costs for the quarantine staff. So there were multiple challenges with the hospitals were dealing and are still dealing with. Now the government order, which I think came into effect on 30th of April, and then we made some representation and then it got revised on 21st May. And initially it was applicable up to 31st August with 80-20 reservation, I mean 80% reservation by the government. And it now got reduced to 50% for non-COVID, and COVID is still continues to about 80%. So it impacted the non-COVID top line, I would say, by about 20-25% on the earned revenue. So, but with this 50% now coming in case of non-COVID, I think it's a better situation. Because you can imagine that the lowest class occupancy of the hospital would be around 40-50%. So sort of, you know, it falls in place now for the non-COVID. So what government can additionally do in this situation to, you know, sort of help the hospital in continuation to what I said earlier, is that, you know, in about a month or so, I think current order is about applicable up to 30th November, but I think there can be interim review of that, and the COVID regulation there also can be dropped to 50% from 80%. That will also give some respite to the hospital. The other is there should not be extension beyond 30th November for sure. That is something that I hope would happen. I'm also surprised that why still the government has not looked at the GST waiver on the COVID-related items. We still have to pay GST on the PPE items, all these, you know, the PPE kits, your gloves, your caps, and, you know, all these items. So that is something that government can definitely waive to make it sort of cost-effective for the hospitals and the patients. There can be some stimulus. I think there is no mention of any stimulus package for the healthcare, and there can be some subsidies given to the hospital sector towards the electricity cost. I mean, it's a wishful thinking that they can also consider the refund of the GST input credit, because hospitals cannot claim that, and that also is an additional cost to the hospitals. Something can be also looked at, you know, towards the property tax, if it can be further toned down. And also, as I said, that something like government-backed financing will have to be provided to the sector to sort of give it, you know, the immediate relief. And I already mentioned about the CSR rules, and they can also look at the fast-tracking the disputes and the refunds wherever they are due to the hospital.
So coming from there, Dr. Desai, UK and Australia had examples of government working with the private sector through strategic purchasing of capacity at a no-profit, no-loss basis. Do you think there is a need for a similar model to be implemented in India as well?
So I think, you know, I had an opportunity to visit Australia once under a PPP scheme of World Bank, and I had seen and gone those schemes there. So one interesting thing which I found out was what they were doing was they were actually buying capacity. So, you know, so they were not saying that, okay, like what Mr. Jaisingh said, that the rates of cancer care, say radiation therapy, are too low, you know, you can't afford. But what they were saying, that you treat, you know, say 1,000 cases a month, you treat 200 bypass, you treat, you know, so many outpatients. How you charge, what you charge is not an issue at all. Okay, we will give you the budget that we would have for so many cases to be treated. And then whatever is the spare capacity that you have, you can, you know, use it the way you want to. So I thought that was probably, it would need to be tweaked here in India due to volumes, but that was not a bad option to look at, you know, where you are not, say, sort of fixing rates, but you are fixing capacities, you know, that, and then whatever is the extra capacity, you can use it for your private patients and your paying class of patients. So that I thought was something that, you know, we should probably try. That would also encourage participation. The other thing which I think, because India's problem is the private sector and the public sector is 180 degrees, you know. A private hospital cannot be compared with a private hospital, I mean, public hospital. They don't have that kind of problem. NHS hospitals are more or less, you know, as good or bad as what a private sector would be, and so is true in Australia. And both the countries have tax paid by the citizens towards healthcare, which we don't have in India as yet. You know, Ayushman Bharat probably is the first attempt on doing something like that, and universal health coverage will come, you know, the other one. But I think other thing what government can do, you know, going forward from here, because no hospital chain now is willing to look at capex funding, you know. They will not invest because they have to conserve cash as much as possible, you know, for future expenses. So something like what the REIT, you know, system, the real estate trust kind of a system, if that comes in, probably that will help us, because, you know, then there is someone who owns the asset who is not looking at a, you know, very phenomenal return on the asset, but he's willing to put in that, you know, money into that. In fact, after this call, you know, I have a meeting around that from someone from Singapore wanting to do that kind of a stuff in India. So that's one thing where a big ticket item of capital can be taken away through a REIT format, and the operator comes in, invests in the equipment, which also can be lease financed, and then he, you know, runs it the way it can be. So that's one way. The other thing, you know, which I understand, which is happening in this pandemic, was in at least the first 4 months, there was absolute no import that was happening, you know, because there was no cargo movement unless highly, you know, emergency cargo. So this, you know, means the government should encourage a lot of investment into this Atmanirbhar Bharat kind of a scheme, you know, where you have most of the equipment that you buy today. You know, Pradeep said about linear accelerator, I think all of them are imported. We don't have the capacity to do it in-house. You know, MRI, CT scans, all of that. So, you know, we are currently involved with IIT Kanpur, you know, the first of its kind school of medicine and research technology on the campus of IIT Kanpur. The idea being that medicine and engineering should work together, you know, yes, so that we get this incentivization of creating technology which is suited to Indian conditions and would be cheaper than what you are, you know, getting it from outside. So I think, I hope that that gets, you know, fair funding. There's already some funds allocated. So those kinds of things probably will need to be encouraged, that we produce ourselves. You know, I mean, that is a classic example of what happened with PPE kits. We were manufacturing none, and today within a 7-8 months period, you are a net exporter of PPE kits. You know, similar is the case with ventilators. So those kind of things will probably, you know, help us. One thing which, you know, I would like to point out, and that struck me from what, you know, the Fortis chairman mentioned in Economic Times, it was there that he probably thinks that, you know, by the end of this fiscal year, he would probably bring it back to an EBITDA zero level, at least if not EBITDA positive. The reason being, he said that they have been able to, so healthcare 100 rupees spent in hospitals, 40 is towards salary, 40-45. I would, is that right? You know, Pradeep, or, you know,
yes.
Yeah. So out of that, half is towards the doctor, or maybe more. So what they said was, doctors were willing to take that little bit of a hit because the work was, you know, very low. So that probably has helped some of these hospital chains to bring the cost down, you know. The consumable is a variable anyway. So if you are not, you know, spending, your inventory probably will have to be managed properly so that, you know. So I think over a period, hospitals will swing back. I don't think that, you know, they will have a very major problem there. But again, said and done, we also found that, you know, this disease did not have enough of postgraduate doctors, specialized doctors, which were, you know, trained. So the government, as of I think 3 days back, come up with a scheme where private hospitals like Jaslok or, you know, even ICC kind of hospital chains will be allowed to train postgraduates without being, you know, an undergraduate institution. So this was not there before. We were only giving DNBs and CPS seats, but this will be like MD and MS, you know. So radiation oncology, as he rightly said, I mean, India needs 400 linear accelerators to go up to maybe 2000, but do we have enough radiation, you know, oncologists and technicians? We don't, you know, so we will have to do part of this in-house. We cannot, you know, afford to have, and the industry will also have to come forward to, you know, do something on those lines. So I think if we take this as a challenge, probably we will emerge stronger.
Rightly said, Dr. Desai. I mean, in India, the difference between, you know, the public and private care is different, vastly different as compared to, say, UK and Australia. And I think we also would need to have a better idea of the costs that are incurred in the private sector for us to be able to, for the government to be able to appreciate it and, you know, partner with the private sector in such times as well.
I just want to, you know, say something, Preet, about that, taking up from Jitendra. I think there is a system called resource-based related value system, you know. So if an MRI, so So Jaslow probably has a 3 Tesla MRI, and the guy next door to me has a 0.5 Tesla MRI. He also sells 5,000 and he's also selling at 5,000. So if we have this RBRBS system, it actually takes into account the infrastructure qualitatively, you know, the type of human resource which is running it, and the pricing is then, you know, tweaked to the advantage of Jaslow, so that this person would get about 2,500, he would still make a margin, and Jaslow will have to charge more because of the infrastructure and the quality of technology and doctors.
Right. So next, my next question is to Mr. Jaisingh. Mr. Jaisingh, healthcare as an industry has been traditionally, you know, reluctant to adopt digitization. If you see across industries, it is one of the laggards in adopting digitization. But given that, you know, the pandemic and the COVID crisis, the whole thing has been accelerated. Now, what are the trends and investments that you're seeing in the digital space, given your experience with innovative business models? And do you think that, you know, the same can be sustained post-COVID as well?
Yes, of course. I think industry has been a laggard, not only in India, but in US as well, but trying to catch up, definitely trying to catch up fast. And we've actually been pretty surprised pleasantly by the level of innovation and at least efforts at entrepreneurship that are coming up, from across India. We would like to see more, but certainly both at HealthStart, where we have more than 20 companies in the portfolio, plus in my individual capacity, as well as at Indian Angels and Stanford Angels, we continue to support multiple healthcare startups. And so three areas are emerging. One is point of care diagnostics. And that is a critical area, because I think the diagnostics, both in terms of the speed as well as accuracy, if they can be enabled, then the treatment and the care, continuum of care, can be managed more effectively. And so we are seeing some effort there, but certainly more need to be done. The other is other area where digital health initiatives have had some success is chronic disease management. Now, that is a huge area because India is following the same trend like the US and other Western countries in terms of very heavy disease burden for lifestyle diseases, especially in urban areas, and India is no exception. So disease management is another area for certain very innovative startups. Two of them, I've funded, ourselves. And so they are in diabetes management. Early diagnosis of cancer is another area where we are seeing several attempts. Nothing has been really backbreaking as of now, but I think several attempts that are really good, and one that we are currently looking at. So that is another area. Then there are other areas in terms of medical devices that are innovative. I think Dr. Desai mentioned about it in the context of IIT Kanpur. I would love to see not only just one IIT, but almost all the IITs integrating medical equipment and devices into the engineering talent, and because I think IITs are really well placed, and ISC well placed to integrate that. And if these technologies can be integrated and that expertise applied to medical care or the devices innovation, I think India can have an advantage there because it does have a lower cost base. But so far, our medical devices story from India has been very, very mediocre. I would say disappointing, but that needs to change. Then the fourth area would be obviously also, in terms of enabling reduced cost of care, better access and reduced cost of care, like all these companies in telehealth and e-health were struggling. But at least COVID, one positive that has come out of that very clearly is that telehealth is no longer a what if option, but it is really, the adoption has been off the charts. The issue would be, can this be sustained at least to some degree? And the answer is, I think it would
somewhere be in between. It would not remain at these levels, but it will also not go back to the earlier levels. It would be somewhere in between, and rightly so, because I think this can be done more effectively. But on the other hand, what we saw because of COVID is that even patients like cancer patients not keeping up their appointments, even for things like chemotherapy or for radiation therapy, and that should not happen as well. So I think the digital health will continue to play an increasing role, an increasingly important role, and therefore more innovation needs to happen. But we also have lack of funding. Initiatives like Health Start are small and isolated. We need to have multiple accelerators, multiple sources of funding, more angel investors who are keen to support healthcare ventures, because we have very few of them really taking that risk. And therefore, I would really like to see that happen. But I think we are making some progress.
Thanks, Mr. Jaisingh. Let's hope that trend continues and we continue innovating going forward. Mr. Jitendra, the pandemic has hit smaller hospitals and nursing homes pretty hard. And we read about reports of some of them potentially looking to close down. Now, do you think going forward in the industry, there will be a consolidation happening with M&A activity, picking up in the sector with the larger players trying to, pick up the smaller hospital chains and expand?
Yeah, so if you really see now from the finance perspective, I think we have a situation of short and medium term crisis. So, it will perhaps lead to close down in some cases if no timely support provided. And in some cases, there could be consolidation possible in the form of takeover and M&A. So, it's quite possible. However, every place will not have a taker, because as you see that when there is a takeover or M&A or investment happens, obviously there is some consideration and, the deal needs to look lucrative. So it may not be the solution for all. So therefore, every place will not have a taker. And therefore, the role of government in this case is going to be very important as we are talking about it. So I feel that, government will have to really parent the sector and give it the requisite and timely support in terms of financing, et cetera, whatever it is. And I also, back what Dr. Desai said that, this REIT model, I think, has a lot of potential in this time. I think, if there are funds, who sort of float this kind of REIT models, I think there'll be a lot of takers. And I think I see, quite a potential for this particular thing to sort of shape up in the coming time. I also feel that, in these times, while, these other avenues, options are open, such as M&A takeover, but, government can also proactively set up maybe a high-level committee to, review the health of the hospitals, especially the smaller hospitals, nursing homes, to check what exactly is happening. And, on lighter note, that hospitals would also need a health checkup now. And, based on that, review, the observations, there should be a plan to sort of support the smaller nursing homes and smaller hospitals.
Yes, the government could certainly step in and help the healthcare sector, as you rightly said.
I think most importantly, they need to parent the sector. I mean, they cannot just, abandon and, sort of be on their own. I think there should be a collective sort of, approach towards the sector.
So Dr. Desai, virtually, you have been associated with a lot of projects. Virtually all new projects are on hold, as you mentioned, with major players putting a halt to fresh capex, in most cases, even recurring capex is on hold. Some of the investors are also, finding that avenues within the healthcare industry like pharmacy, digital health, medtech are more attractive than the traditional hospitals. So, that has further accentuated the shortage of beds. The cost of delivery of care in government sector is higher than in the private sector. And the government finances are also strained. And they are not in a position to expand the infrastructure. What are your thoughts in leveraging the PPP model in healthcare for hospitals as well as medical colleges?
Right. So I think that's correct. You know, the interest in high capex has gone down, and most of the capex that would happen probably will be through the government, you know, coming in. So say, for example, we are doing a Tata Cancer expansion. So that is funded through the government. So, you know, this will be massive 8 linear accelerators in one hospital I have never heard of. But that apart, you know, the other projects that we are currently doing are more to do with an NGO sector, you know, where it was already a CSR funding available. Private sector has put on hold. But the interesting trend that I am seeing is, we've been receiving inquiries from a lot of hotel owners, you know, because hotel as a business is going to go, you know, it's not going to pick up very soon either. So many of them are saying, doctor, can you help us find an operator? Okay, I'm willing to convert this, you know, infrastructure into, and in big cities as well as in smaller towns, you know, people have put on hold their hotels and their, so that is something which can happen, but that is probably not going to make a major impact in terms of asset creation. Asset creation will have to be more in tier 2 and tier 3 towns, you know, because that is where population is and it is without healthcare. You know, I belong to Konkan Belt, you know, in Maharashtra. And today, if I talk to my village, you know, they have absolute no healthcare available. You know, there has been 7 days and they have not been even getting reports of the COVID test done. So that's the kind of, you know, infrastructure we have. So that can only be done through PPP. I don't see there is any other, you know, big private players wanting to go there. No, nobody is going to sink a 50 crore or 100 crore, you know, project into rural India. So that will have to be through a PPP platform. There is no other way that I can, you know, see. Also, what I found interestingly is that, you know, though we're doing some projects for Exim Bank in Maldives and Africa and some of those areas where India is funding. But similarly, what we have found is that there are also now a fair amount of interest from Japanese, you know, and Japanese funding is available at a very low cost. Okay, and yen is probably a more stable currency as against the dollar. What Mr. Jaisingh was saying when he started to invest was 40, now it is 75. I don't know how it compares with yen, but that kind of a model will also work. So we're exploring 2 or 3 opportunities where the government is looking at low cost funding long term, you know, but it will be public health. It won't be, you know, private sector involvement. But that will create that infrastructure which is required. So currently we are looking at the Northeast, you know, then Central India, you know, states like Jharkhand, states like Madhya Pradesh, you know, states like Uttar Pradesh, where this is lacking. So those kind of things. But your point is very correct that I don't see any other way but public-private partnership, because a medical college project, like you said, it's not less than 500 crore worth of investment. You know, so this is not like, and not everyone can invest that kind of money, even if you privatize it, you know, because there are capping now on all medical student fees, and plus the entrance is through NEET. So you cannot have any other mechanism but merit, you know, going forward. So those kind of projects, the government will have to step in, you know, they will have to give. So like IIT Kanpur, probably they should encourage, you know, because IIT has good amount of land. So those kind of, you know, so land is something which the government can bring in. They can bring in some element of, you know, subsidized funding in terms of long tenure loans, whether they give it or they talk to ADB or World Bank or, you know, or Japanese like JVIC or JICA, you know, which has funded. I think the AIIMS Trauma Center came through a JICA funding, you know, IIT Hyderabad got some JICA funding, you know, how this bullet train, you know, kind of a funding, which is long-term softer debt. So that kind of a thing will need to be brought in. Plus, if that viability gap funding mechanism, what they had floated a year ago in the budget, it has not taken off, that probably will, you know, entice people to reinvest in healthcare. After a gap of maybe 1 year or 18 months, you will again see some interest from the private sector to come in. But yes, you know, point well taken, private PPP is the way to go forward to improve the reach of healthcare.
Yes, Dr. Desai. Thanks for those insights. Now, one last question for all the panelists to wrap up the session. You know, the COVID crisis is clearly here to stay. I mean, we have already, you know, spent 6 months going into the crisis. Probably it will go on for another 6 months to 9 months. We do not know the end of it. hospitals are going to have to revisit their operating model and innovate in the new normal to sustain themselves. Outpatient numbers are going to be going down, lower revenues. You have traditional profit pools in outpatient pharmacies, diagnostics. What steps do you think hospitals would need to take to sustain themselves going forward? And if I could start with you, Mr. Jai Singh.
You're on mute. Mr. Jai Singh, you're on mute.
Yes, I think so. The crisis is also an opportunity in that sense. I think it is time for hospitals to adapt and create hybrid models. I think so. One positive outcome possible from this is faster adoption of technology and digital health. Jitendra in his hospital can probably vouch for this, but I have been talking to multiple hospital CEOs. So this faster adoption of technology and integrating digital health models for the post-COVID world would be one area. Second would be, of course, I think hospitals can integrate both telehealth as well as e-pharmacies and other models also and can benefit and can collaborate essentially with the independent players as well. The things like OPDs and all of that, I think they will, like I mentioned, they will not go back to pre-COVID levels. There will some telehealth, teleconsultations, higher levels will continue, but that's okay. The hospitals can, continue to, derive revenue from that as well, but convert them into the IPDs and the procedures and the rest of the other diseases which are more revenue generating for hospitals. So learn to leverage the technology to derive better revenue through that. So that would be one. The second would be, I think, a better preparedness. I think healthcare delivery systems world over were caught on the wrong foot, including in cities like New York, and then in countries like Italy and Spain, and of course here in India. We need to learn better. The government needs to also create a national integrated system. We have an institute in Pune, but I think we need to do better in terms of getting prepared for things like that. So our entire healthcare system doesn't collapse and doesn't feel like that we are so overwhelmed that we really do not know what to do. I think the world needs to learn how to do better. And I think we, in some sense, will learn.
Better preparedness and adoption of higher digital tech is what you suggest. Thanks, Mr. Jai Singh. Mr. Jitendra, your thoughts?
Yes, so I think, just to build on what Mr. Jai Singh said, I think in my view, the first and foremost is, in this time to ensure that the sanity and safety of staff is maintained, because, more and more staff getting infected would mean that less staff would be available to work. So, the hospitals need to take necessary precautions to ensure that the staff is safe, because currently you can imagine that the spread is very high in the community and there is a fatigue of, because of lockdown restrictions. The other is there should be clear segmentation of zones in the hospital. So, what is green, what is red, what is orange. I'm sure that many hospitals would have done, but this is also very important from the patient safety point of view. Reduction of length of stay wherever possible. So if it's possible to send patients home within 6 days instead of 10 days, if that can be done to reduce the exposure of the patient into the hospital, that is something that can be looked upon. The other is, as Mr. Jai Singh said, that there'll be a lot of thrust upon now the home care and the virtual health platform, because not many patients now want to come to hospitals for consultation. So, this has to be now, they are expecting that the hospitals would now reach out to them, at their doorstep. So this is something is a way forward now. The other is obviously to raise more and more awareness of the safety, about the safety in the hospital to the patient, share with them the testimonials, tell them what sort of precautions you're taking so that, patients feel assured to walk into the hospital. The other is obviously, I think what can be done is every hospital has a different case, so they can look at their fixed expenses and see what can be cut down, what can be negotiated with the vendors on, like CMC cost, rental cost, wherever possible, the fee arrangement, so that can be done. And you know, I think every hospital needs to have now, going forward, at least 3 to 6 months projection to see where they will be and what sort of challenges they would face in next 3 to 6 months, and be ready, be prepared towards that.
So better cost management and better customer CRM kind of a thing is what hospitals would need to do going forward. Dr. Desai, closing comments from your end?
Yeah, so I think, you know, I would just add to what both of them have said. So I think hospitals definitely are going to embrace technology. Telehealth is here to stay. But I think they will also probably go a step forward and have a very strong home healthcare component attached to it. You know, because many of these patients don't want now to come to hospitals. You know, why people have not gone for cancer care or elective surgeries is because they were scared that, you know, of the infection. So that is something probably will happen. Home healthcare will become better. I think there will be a lot of emphasis on diagnostics, you know, especially laboratories. Most of the laboratories have almost made a killing in this COVID care. You know, there have been laboratory chains who have from a loss making become EBITDA positive in 6 months itself. So there will be that emphasis, you know, on better diagnostics. I also think that they will, you know, come out and start to look at seriously having satellite centers. So some of the better nursing homes, which are smaller hospitals, probably will get a co-investment from the larger guy, you know, so that becomes a satellite. It refers, you know, super specialty work to the hospital. But in times like this, that hospital probably will come in handy, you know, to treat patients. Then there will also be an emphasis on improvement on infrastructure, something that we have always shied away from, you know, because we don't want buildings to cost much. But Jitendra will bear me out that this indoor air quality has become a major issue now in this COVID, you know, kind of a thing. So you need to have a negative pressure air, you know, and you never know, this is COVID today, there'll be some other AY, you know, XYZ disease later. So infrastructure improvement, you know, will happen now, you know, and this physical distancing, we know the in Bombay, especially how hospitals are, you know, we are scrounging for space. So that probably is going to change. You know, you will see hospitals of tomorrow to be better, you know, the better equipped to handle something like this. And one more thing I think is, you know, training of human resource. I think there will be now emphasis on training of human resource in a better way. You know, so we don't have critical care nurses, we don't have respiratory technicians, you know, we don't have qualified, resident doctors. All of that has come to fore. I mean, I cannot be treating patients with a third year MBBS student or a second year MBBS student. So all of this, I think hospitals will invest, you know, more now. That's my take, yeah.
Yeah, interesting thoughts, Dr. Desai. Investment in infrastructure, training, and probably, I mean, one of the interesting aspects was the satellite centers that you mentioned, with more and more people looking to, you know, also look at care outside hospitals. So maybe you could see probably, you know, diagnostic centers, collection centers at hospital could be setting out outside, or maybe even OPD clinics in neighborhoods where people could come without the fear of having to go to a hospital.
That's true.
Thanks to all the panelists. Thanks, Mr. Jaisingh, Mr. Jitendra, and Dr. Desai for an engaging discussion. And I hope the audience has gained useful insights from it.
And thanks,
thanks
to you,
everyone, for your time.
Yeah, thank you, Dr. Mr. Preet.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you all for the time.
Have organized.